Our speaker tonight, John Matteson, is a neighbor of ours in New York City. He teaches English at CUNY's John Jay College of Criminal Justice, with a law degree from Harvard and a PhD in English from Columbia. John combines an exquisite literary sensibility with a very clear eye for detail. His first book, Eden's Outcasts, the story of Louisa May Alcott and her father, won the Pulitzer Prize for biography in 2007. His most recent work, Margaret Fuller, The Lives of Margaret Fuller, as he titled it, appeared in 2012. And John told me recently that he researched this new book chiefly at Harvard College's library, which interestingly, Margaret Fuller was the first woman ever to be granted access to. At the center, we're especially interested in turning points in people's lives, moments of personal transformation and growth in vocation. I think John is especially interested in these as well. And he probes key moments in Fuller's life which tested her and opened up new terrain. We'll have time for a conversation. Those of you who've been to other events of ours know how we work. John will speak for a good piece of time. And then we're going to begin a conversation together, which will then open up to the rest of you. And I hope that you'll help me with some probing and generative questions. I'm so pleased that some of my colleagues at NYU are here, Martha Hodes and John Zimmerman. Are you still here? Who teaches at 6:45 and will have to slip out, as well as my center council members, Susan Wallach, Jane Donaldson, and John Morning. To all of you, my many friends, old and new, I welcome you to this evening. And now, John Matteson.
Well, good evening. Thank you very much. Thank you in particular for coming out on this Antarctic evening on Washington Square Park. I hoofed it over here from the one line and had thoughts of turning back, saying to myself, well, no one else is going to be here tonight because it's so ridiculously frigid out. And then it occurred to me that some people might actually just be walking along the street shivering and see the sign and ducking in for warmth. And I was thinking, well, maybe the two will balance out, and it appears that they have. So whatever happens for the next hour and 15 minutes, at least the heat is on. So we'll be thankful for that. I'm grateful for this opportunity to speak with all of you, particularly since I'm going to be sharing a program with Stacey Schiff and Ron Chernow and James Atlas. I figure this is my one chance to kind of get you before I get overshadowed by some really extraordinary people. And Philip, I want to thank you, obviously, for bringing me here this evening. It's a delight. It's a thrill, and it's really to me a unique privilege being invited here to speak at the Center for the Study of Transformative Lives. The privilege is unique, I think, because the center is unique. Now it's a misunderstood, it's a overused adjective, unique. A couple of years ago, I took my daughter on a tour of about 14 colleges when she was getting ready to leave high school, and every tour that we went on told us at least two things that we could always count on: one, that the school we were at was very unique, and that it was just like Hogwarts. Now, if it's just like Hogwarts, it's not unique, and then very unique makes no sense, but you know where I'm going with that. Anyway, but this center is unique. It's truly one of a kind in its conviction that the study of goodness and greatness actually does matter, that history's great examples of courage and conscience have something essential and invigorating to teach us, and that we do very well when we respond to an extraordinary life, not in a spirit of narrow or self-congratulatory criticism, but in a spirit of humility and emulation. A couple of weeks ago, I mentioned to a very close and highly intelligent friend of mine at John Jay that I was coming to speak here, and he unfortunately had not previously heard of the center. And when he heard its name, he responded somewhat warily. Just how, he wanted to know, does one go about carving out a separate category for transformative lives? After all, he said cagily, don't we all transform? Well, I managed some kind of reply, but I know now, I think, what I should have said. Had my wits been more about me, I would have responded somewhat like this. Why, yes, Professor Hall, we do all transform. Indeed, when it comes to the mere act of transforming, we have no choice whatsoever in the matter. But, setting aside the few unfortunate people who have no control over their actions and impulses, we do have a great deal of choice about how we are going to transform. We can choose to transform ourselves in ways that are consistent with the principles of thoughtfulness, of charity, and honor, or we may choose not to. Moreover, in ways both large and small, we are continually in the process of transforming one another. And here again, we have choice. But if we do not make ourselves conscious of the fact that we are choosing, we're likely to do a good deal of harm, both to ourselves and the people around us. It seems to me that the Center for the Study of Transformative Lives is dedicated to a kind of consciousness raising, but not in the sort of hippy-dippy fashion that phrase often gets bandied about in. The Center wants us to think carefully about people who were supremely aware of their power to produce change, and to observe how they did it, and to discover how they managed to move the world in the direction of their own redemptive visions. In Fors Clavigera, a book that deserves to be read much more widely than it is, the British art critic John Ruskin wrote that there were three intangible things without which we would not know how to live. The quality at the top of Ruskin's list was admiration. Now, in saying this, he was emphatically not referring to a need to be admired by others. To the contrary, he was talking about the need that we have to admire. We must have the power of discerning and taking delight in what is lovely in human character, and we must desire to attain that loveliness ourselves. In other words, we have to have figures present in our lives of whom we think well, and the awareness of whom can motivate us to become better than we would otherwise be. I take it as a part of the mission of this center to rescue and restore the idea of the hero, and to give heroic ideas a renewed potency in the hearts and minds of those who come here. Our work here would do very little if we thought that the transformative power of the lives we study were all in the past. The task of such a center is certainly to inform, but it is more fundamentally to inspire. We are here, I think, because we are willing to take seriously the moral function of education. And this is indeed an excellent use of the life that I'm about to discuss tonight, the life, or as I have called it, the lives of Margaret Fuller. Now, there seems to be an inescapable hazard in writing the title of one's lecture before one actually writes the lecture. I advertise this talk as being about Margaret Fuller and the reinvention of American womanhood, and I'm going to get to that. But it now occurs to me that this occasion calls for a somewhat broader approach. For while it's true that Fuller reconceived American womanhood, that achievement is but one of the ways in which her life may be called transformative. Fuller's all-consuming project was progress and change. She was forever casting off her own identity of the moment in search of a new one. She was, by the same token, eager to serve as a catalyst for change in the thoughts and habits of those around her. And throughout the last decade of her life, she also grew ever more dedicated to the project of social reform, both at home and abroad. She said, as I've noted in my title, "Mine are well-spent days." They were also restless days, days filled with thought, and one wonders, at how much she accomplished at so little a time. When one speaks of Margaret Fuller's as a transformative life, one therefore needs to think of her in at least four different modes. We have to first consider Fuller as the protean self-transformer, then Fuller the life-altering mentor of her friends and colleagues, and then Fuller the reforming revolutionary who did all that one woman could do to alter the political life of not one, but two nations. Only in relation to all of those transformative powers and effects can one fully understand Fuller's transformation of the way we conceive the possibilities of womanhood. Now, that's a crazy amount of ground to try to cover in a single talk. And in a spirit of both conciseness and mercy, I'm not going to try that hard to cover all of the bases. But I do want to give you enough of this remarkable person to begin to illustrate how, in the mind of Margaret Fuller, endless reinvention was essential to her idea of a well-formed society and of a life well-lived. In her early 30s, as many of you know, Margaret Fuller considered herself a transcendentalist. The movement was well-suited to her in that transcendental thinking never kept still for very long. The quicksilver quality of mind that characterized Emerson and Thoreau, that proclivity of leaping from one idea to another, from one contradiction to another, before the ink was dry that wrote out the previous idea, is a hallmark of transcendental thought. It was not for nothing that Emerson wrote that a foolish inconsistency is the hobgoblin of little minds. You may know the story of Emerson when he was still a Unitarian minister, when he paused in the middle of a sermon, stopped dead in his tracks to announce, "I no longer believe what I just said." Yet while Emerson and Thoreau were philosophically dedicated to the idea of perpetual change, they themselves seemed to me to have changed relatively little over the courses of their respective careers. To my ears, at least, Emerson in 1860 doesn't sound all that different from Emerson in 1836. And Thoreau, too, for all of his revolutionary qualities, remained fairly constant in his ideas about revolution. Fuller, by contrast, was a person forever physically and mentally on the move. The American transcendentalists intended for people to respond to their thought, which was itself highly eccentric, in personal, even idiosyncratic ways. When I consider the word transcendentalism, it's an ingrained habit for me to think of two moments of individual epiphany that were experienced by two indispensable members of the movement. You can think of these as sort of instantaneous revelations that, for me, sum up the deepest convictions of a generation of American thinkers. Those moments, which I'm about to share with you, reveal a confidence in the moral vitality of the universe, a belief that nature is humanly sensitive and sympathetic, and that one may react to it in a way that is both communication and communion. The first of these two moments is a staple of the Norton anthology. It is the passage early in his long essay on nature, in which Ralph Waldo Emerson tells of walking on a winter evening through snow puddles and suddenly becoming conscious of the utter majesty of existence. He writes, words that you may know, "Standing on the bare ground, my head bathed by the blithe air and uplifted into infinite space, all mean egotism vanishes. I become a transparent eyeball. I am nothing. I see all. The currents of the universal being circulate through me. I am part or particle of God." What Emerson was narrating was a kind of non-sectarian conversion experience. The other passage in the transcendental oeuvre is far less well known, but it might have been written as a companion piece for Emerson's Reverie. It was written, as you may have guessed, by Fuller. And it recalls an afternoon from just about this time of year in 1831, when Fuller was 21 years old. Fuller was then fully grown, but she was not yet fully fledged as a thinker or as an independent person, and the shape of her future was quite far from being determined. She had been a childhood prodigy. Under the sometimes overly watchful tutelage of her education-obsessed father, Timothy, she had absorbed Latin so avidly that she could translate Virgil by the age of 9. Tried this with my daughter. It didn't work. We'll try that again. By 15, Fuller had been through Byron and Rousseau. She had studied Epictetus, Milton, Racine, and Madame de Stael with great delight. She knew no small amount of classical Greek, and she had supplemented her knowledge of ancient languages with a strong understanding of German. She also occupied a place of social privilege. She was the eldest daughter of a four-term Massachusetts congressman who had regularly shared a church pew with John Quincy Adams and was, for a time, one of the best-known politicians in the Northeast. And yet, as she began her 20s, Margaret Fuller had only the most nebulous sense of the person she was supposed to be, in large part because no one around her had any idea of what an educated American woman was supposed to do. Fuller had danced and chatted with her share of Harvard boys. She'd even been to a finishing school. But she suspected that her role in life was meant to be something more than matrimonial, maternal, and ornamental. But she could not see the way forward. At 21, as she went through the socially prescribed motions, she felt hypocritical and inwardly absent. And then came Thanksgiving 1831, when, after church services, Fuller wandered off by herself. Feeling that she had no place in the world, she did not know how she could return to the empty mockery of a life, that kind of life that she had been living. She found herself in a dark wood, very, Dantesque, actually, next to a still, cold pond. But then, everything changed. Suddenly, she wrote, the sun shone out with that transparent sweetness like the last smile of a dying lover, which it will use when it has been unkind all a cold autumn day. And even then passed into my thought a beam from its true sun, from its native sphere, which has never since departed from me. At that moment of transformation and transcendence, four questions entered her mind, questions that she had first asked herself when she was only a child. How came I here? How is it that I seem to be this Margaret Fuller? What does it mean? What shall I do about it? She left the woods with the conviction that existence was, above all else, a gift with which something must be done. Her life thereafter became a string of startling firsts. You've already heard from Philip that she was the first woman ever granted admission to the Harvard College Library. She also edited the country's first experimental literary magazine, The Dial. She wrote the groundbreaking treatise on women's rights in America, Woman in the 19th Century, 3 years before the Seneca Falls Convention, generally regarded as the founding moment of American feminism, took place. And she became the first regular foreign correspondent, male or female, for an American newspaper when she went to Europe under the auspices of Horace Greeley's New York Tribune. Now, I have no sure way of knowing that what I'm about to suggest is true, but it tallies with everything else that I've come to understand about Margaret Fuller. It has struck me that Fuller, with her fluent knowledge of German and her capacities as an accomplished translator of Goethe, was very likely impressed by the fact that the German verb used to form the future tense, werden, is also the word that means to become. It was embedded in Fuller's consciousness, as it appears to be rooted in the logic of the German language, that the very act of passing into the future was a kind of becoming. Necessarily, it involved change. One's choice in the matter extended only to how one was going to change and the amount of responsibility one intended to take for it. Now, whether my suppositions about Verden meant to Fuller, what Verden meant to Fuller are correct, I can state with confidence that she was highly familiar with the closing scenes of Goethe's Faust Part II. Now, Faust, as you probably know, has not lived a particularly angelic life. His pursuit of knowledge and power has been unconscionably selfish, and with the help of Mephistopheles, he has wrought bitter devastation on an innocent victim and her family. Yet, Faust has excelled in another dimension. He has worked tirelessly to shape himself into a superior intellect and transform himself, and in some ways the world around him, into a relentlessly progressive state. As the play nears its end, and Faust falls dead, Mephistopheles prepares to claim his soul for eternal damnation. However, at that moment, a host of angels appears, intent on carrying Faust's spirit in an upward direction. When the devil protests, the angels reply, "Whoever strives with all his power, we are allowed to save." For Goethe, redemption was to be found only in a ceaseless struggle to draw oneself out, to reach ever higher toward a perfection of knowledge and self-realization. Whatever its rewards, an existence of ceaseless striving is a hard way to live. Pursuing Goethe's ideal demands a perpetual dissatisfaction with oneself. One can always be better, and the anxious knowledge of one's own incompleteness never leaves one alone or at ease. It is, in this limited sense, the romantic counterpart of Puritan Christianity. Fuller felt the constant dissatisfaction with her own imperfections, but she also felt their incessant challenge. She took upon herself the obligation to continually raise her level of knowledge and compassion to make of herself the most evolved being she could be. I believe, Fuller wrote, in eternal progression. I believe in a God, a beauty and perfection to which I am to strive all my life for assimilation. From these two articles of belief, I draw the rules by which I strive to regulate my life. Now, because Fuller was raised in a household where levels of attention and affection were varied according to how much she was learning, it was only natural that her friendships tended to have a pedagogical flavor. She wasn't really interested in the static, non-transformative relation of mere companionship. She demanded interaction, and she demanded it of a kind that produced a synthesis with the other person's intellect and with his or her emotions, raising both parties to new levels of knowledge and sympathy. She was drawn to people to whom she could teach and from whom she could learn, and they, for the most part, but not always, were drawn to her. When people spoke about her, they often recalled the education that they had received at her hands. With her superior command of Latin, Fuller was highly familiar with another important linguistic fact, that the very word education comes from a Latin root, educare, which means to draw out. She knew, at its core, that education did not signify the cramming in of information. It meant using sympathetic and persuasive means to reach within the other and to draw to the surface the best of what lies within. One of those who experienced Fuller's educative power most acutely was the prominent Unitarian minister, James Freeman Clark. Clark and Fuller had known each other since childhood, but their relationship matured only when they reached their 20s. An intelligent young man of strong enthusiasms, Clark accused himself of having no power of expression. He wrote, "I've been looked on always as a mass of clay, and justly, for the clay smothered the flame." Seeing his promise as well as the shyness that was keeping it from being fulfilled, Fuller took Clark in hand. They read German together and exchanged long philosophy-drenched letters. Step by step, Fuller lured her friend's intellect out of the shadows. With her already impressive knowledge of the Western canon, she became for him a second university. When Clark had graduated to a greater level of knowledge and confidence and courage, he wrote to her with gratitude as follows. He said, "There is nothing I would conceal from you. I would communicate to you sooner than to anyone else. There are many things you alone can appreciate and understand. I do not wish to separate what is yours from what is mine in the web of my character. Our friendship has been a rare one." And as friendships go, Fuller's connection with Clark was indeed quite unusual. But with her, it was by no means unique, as Clark himself was well aware. He later observed, quote, "What she was to me, she was to many others. Inexhaustible in the power of insight, and with a goodwill broad as ether, she could enter into the needs and sympathize with the various excellences of the greatest variety of characters. One thing only she demanded of all her friends, that they should not be satisfied with the common routine of life, that they should aspire to something higher, better, holier than they had now attained." Clark also noted Fuller's endless curiosity to know other people, not with a vulgar, gossipy intrusiveness, but with a longing to understand what he called, quote, "the inward springs of their thought and the action of their souls," unquote. Once thus acquainted, she used her influence to develop the latent germ of every character. The result of meeting Fuller atop what Clark denoted as this mountain of friendship was, he said, a process of transfiguration. It all began, perhaps, with Fuller's determination as a striving soul to see the very best in every other soul that was likewise striving. Clark wrote, quote, "As the Greeks beheld a Persephone and Athena in a passing stranger, and ennobled humanity into ideal beauty, Margaret saw all her friends idealized. She was a balloon of sufficient power to take us all up with her into the serene depth of heaven." Now, I've tried thus far to show briefly how Fuller's confidence in eternal progression and positive transformation inspired her many transmutations of self and her desire to be a catalyst for the utmost development of the people around her. But Fuller's religion of transformation had its applications not only to the growth of individuals, but also to the lives of nations. That faith was the source of both her greatest hopes and her bitterest frustrations when she looked out upon America. In a poem she wrote in her early 30s, she referred to her country as leveling Ameriki. And in America's leveling propensities, she saw both a bright promise and a daunting danger. She thought it was good indeed that America had no king. However, she felt that in its devotion to the common man, America was producing men and women who were all too common. In a free country, she argued, the true task of the citizen was to become an aristocrat, not socially, but in the greatness of one's thoughts and one's actions. She feared that, instead of raising its people up, the leveling forces of American life had blunted the instinct to aspire. They had created a nation not of godlike men and women, but of satisfied day laborers. She was even more disheartened by the great wellspring of American inequality, the institution of slavery, which she argued had made the idea of American liberty a cruel joke in the eyes of a cynical world. Stunted by slavery, obsessed by wealth, half blinded by its own headlong surge toward prosperity, America was growing physically, but not spiritually. Fuller therefore looked instead for a land of emergent freedom, and she thought that she found it in the revolutionary spirit of Rome in 1848. She had come to Europe as a reporter for, as I said, Horace Greeley's New York Tribune. As she traveled through Great Britain and France, she beheld poverty such as she had never seen at home. She wrote, "The people are crowded together, and the stamp of squalid, stolid misery and degradation is obvious and appalling." She sensed that the dispossessed classes of Europe were edging toward revolution. As Fuller arrived in Italy, the stir of freedom was in the air. Along with other populations across Europe, the people of Rome were calling for expanded political rights. And Pope Pius IX, on whose moral and political authority everything seemed to depend, had expressed sympathy with the democratic cause. Fuller embraced the movement enthusiastically, using her newspaper columns to stir up popular support for the insurgents in the U.S. Later, after Pope Pius, who had suddenly withdrawn his endorsement of the democratic reforms, had been dismissed from power, or forced into exile at least, Fuller urged Washington to recognize the revolutionary government that had driven the pontiff away. She wrote from Rome in 1848, April of that year, "My friends write to urge my return. They talk of our country as the land of the future. It is so. Which gave all of hope with which I can sympathize for that future is more alive at present than here in America. My country is at present spoiled by prosperity, stupid with the lust of gain, soiled by crime in its willing perpetuation of slavery. In Europe, amid the teachings of adversity, a nobler spirit is struggling, a spirit which cheers and animates mine. I hear earnest words of pure faith and love. I see deeds of brotherhood. This is what makes my America." Fuller threw herself into the cause of the Roman Revolution. She began a love affair with a threadbare Marchese who had sided with the rebels and conceived a son with him without first taking the trouble to get married. She continued to fill the pages of the Tribune with impassioned pleas for American aid. When Pope Pius called in a French army to suppress the people's uprising, Fuller accepted the directorship of a hospital where she tended to the insurgency's wounded soldiers. As the final assault by the French forces loomed, she took a place at the barricades alongside the baby's father, her baby's father, determined that if he was to die, she would go with him. The spirit and courage with which Fuller labored on behalf of the eventually defeated revolution may be measured by a remarkable fact. In the entire city of Rome, there is to this day just one street named for an American. That American is not a Roosevelt, it's not Eisenhower, it's not JFK, it's Margaret Fuller. Now, the advertisements that lured you here this evening said that I would discuss Margaret Fuller's reinvention of American womanhood, and I have no desire to disappoint. But before I begin to talk about Fuller's specific contributions to women's rights in America, I'd point out something that you may already have observed, which is that in discussing Fuller's many revisions of self and her effect on her friends and her brave attempts to change the course of events in revolutionary Italy, I have been talking about Fuller's transformation of American womanhood all along. Perhaps there were American women prior to Fuller who imagined a female existence that was dedicated to self-culture, or one that had more to offer men than romance and subservience, or one that could assume a leading part in a political upheaval. But there was no American woman before Margaret Fuller who embraced these visions with such fervor and determination, and who pursued them as an actual present possibility. Had Margaret Fuller never spoken or written a word in support of equality for women, her life would still be a landmark in women's history, for having shown, by its actions alone, that such triumphs were possible. But Fuller did speak and write a great deal about women's equality. It's only reasonable to admit, I'm afraid, that what she said and wrote did not always achieve the kind of impact that she would have wished. When she gave her fabled conversations on women's rights in Boston, an episode that I don't have time to go into tonight, her audiences, though select, were small. When she wrote, she had complicated things to say, and she did not say them simply. Her prose, which was often strewn with references that few readers could be expected to catch, was pedantic and difficult. Emerson lamented her pen was a non-conductor. An alumnus of the erudite utopian community at Brook Farm recalled that the scholars there, quote, read Dante in the original Italian, read Hegel in the original German, and perhaps the hardest task of all, Margaret Fuller in the original English. Then, too, there was the problem of Fuller's being so very far ahead of her time, a fact well illustrated by the remarks of Edgar Allan Poe, yes, that Edgar Allan Poe, upon reading Fuller's treatise on women's rights, Woman in the 19th Century. Poe called Fuller's work, quote, a book which few women in the country could have written, and no woman in the country could have published, with the exception of Miss Fuller. Miss Fuller has erred through her own excessive subjectiveness. She judges woman by the heart and intellect of Miss Fuller, and there are not more than one or two dozen Miss Fullers on the whole face of the earth. Poe, I suppose, underestimated, yet he seems to have been sadly correct in his assessment that, in 1845, American womanhood, to say nothing of American manhood, was largely unprepared for the meteoric force that was Margaret Fuller on women's rights. By 1848, the year of the Seneca Falls Convention, Fuller was already in Europe, fated never to return to her native land. 3 years earlier, as she wrote and published Woman in the 19th Century, Fuller could not have been blamed for feeling entirely, or virtually, alone. I've been suggesting that when Fuller made her bid to reinvent American womanhood, she was writing for an audience that was not yet born. But within that suggestion is another suggestion, which is that, with our greater understanding of women's capacities and our greater openness to freedom made possible by gender equality, we are the very audience that Margaret Fuller was seeking, and that there's value to be gained from listening now with both ears. In writing my more recent book, I spent a few years listening to Margaret Fuller, and here's a small taste of what her work taught me about women, about men, and the need for gender equality. I don't think Fuller's views on equality can be neatly separated from her feelings about the body. To Fuller, the mind and spirit offered endless possibilities. By contrast, the body epitomized finitude and limitation. This was true not only because people of her time who possessed female bodies encountered daily a host of political, economic, and social barriers. Fuller also felt the limits of the body because of the defects in her own physical being. She was severely nearsighted, and she suffered from curvature of the spine. She also suffered devastating migraine headaches and was, throughout her life, as Emerson put it, the victim of disease and pain. If Fuller preferred to live in the rich kingdoms that were her heart and mind and desired for release from the prison of her body, she could hardly be blamed. Fuller's discomfort with her body was deepened by the attractions that it felt and could not consummate. At an impressionable moment, Fuller fell deeply in love with a beautiful young woman named Anna Barker, and Fuller's feelings became for her a bewilderment that she could neither understand nor publicly express. Evidently, she confided her love for Anna only to her journal. There she wrote, "It is so true that a woman may be in love with a woman and a man with a man. It is so pleasant to be sure of it because undoubtedly it is the same love that we shall feel when we are angels, when we ascend to the only fit place for the mignons, where, sie fragen nicht nach Mann und Weib, no one asks if you're a man or a woman." It is regulated by the same law as that of love between persons of different sexes, but it is purely intellectual and spiritual, unprofaned by any mixture of lower instincts. Thus, the beautiful seeks the strong, and the strong the beautiful, the mute seek the eloquent, and the butterfly settles always on the dark flower. Now, Fuller here is really trying to, she's really trying to idealize her love for Anna, but there are also passages in her journal that she wrote the morning after sleeping in the same bed with Anna on a seemingly innocent, friendly basis, but being almost too overwrought by the stimulus to even be coherent. So she may be fooling herself a bit there. Fuller called her love for Anna, quote, a key which unlocked for me many a treasure which I still possess. It was the carbuncle which cast light into many of the darkest caverns of human nature. We both felt such a strange mystic thrill and knew what we had never known before. But Fuller could do nothing about that mystic thrill, and her fraught and frustrating friendship with Anna Ward was yet another reason for her to regret the limitations of gender, the realities of the body, and to yearn for a life where spirits could freely relate to one another, perhaps as body to body, but certainly as soul to soul. Perhaps the thing that drew her most strongly toward transcendentalism was precisely this. She saw in it the promise of a philosophy in which bodies were irrelevant, and the only criteria were the fitness of one's soul, spirit, and mind. But Fuller's more public quarrel with the problems of gender had less to do with unspoken passions and everything to do with her belief that life should be a perpetual project of self-culture and self-realization. She saw all too clearly that the sex roles established by her society had made it next to impossible for a woman to discover her talents and to develop them without restraint or condemnation. In Woman in the 19th Century, she made the strongest case she could for a change in the rules. Fuller's treatise on women's rights began as a long essay in the transcendental magazine, The Dial. The essay was titled The Great Lawsuit, Man versus Men, Woman versus Women. Now, the alignment of the parties to that suit is at first puzzling. Where equal rights were at stake, one might well expect the women to be taking the men both to task and to court, but Fuller would not have it so. The grievance that she wants to address is a contest between man versus men, woman versus women. What does that mean? It is a contest between two visions of each gender, between the ideal that each might achieve and the stunted reality that each had become. The singular nouns, man and woman, represented for Fuller humanity at its highest levels, confident, inspirited, and aspiring to the grandeur of the gods. But the plurals, men and women, were small, degraded versions of this ideal, unconscious of their innate divinity, and dulled by habits of jealousy, skepticism, and myopic self-interest. The lawsuit between man and men, woman and women, was a suit to recover a stolen inheritance, a birthright that people had denied to themselves and one another precisely because they had restricted themselves to cramped, limiting assumptions about what men and women were supposed to be. Fuller deplored the dispensation that had forced women into a state of helpless dependency on their husbands. But she was, by the same token, critical of the customs that had imposed upon men the duty of supporting women in all of their presumed vulnerability. The relationship had made for resentment and misunderstanding on both sides. It had, she said, quote, cooled love, degraded marriage, and prevented either sex from being what it should be to itself or to the other, unquote. Men and women who ought to behave as two halves of one thought were instead at war with one another, to the detriment of both. Fuller proposed a new and equal relation that would affirm the destiny of all humankind and to fulfill the laws of their true being. While anyone is base, Fuller wrote, none can be entirely free and noble. So long as woman was held behind, just so long would man be prevented from rising to his own appointed place. Now, just as Fuller had taken self-improvement as her own personal law, she decreed the same for her fellow women. She insisted, quote, what woman needs is not as a woman to act or rule, but as a nature to grow, as an intellect to discern, as a soul to live freely and unimpeded, to unfold such powers as were given to her when we left our common home. Fuller stated her desire that woman should not be situated within a domestic chain of command, but rather as one of the highest links in the great chain of being. She wrote, "We would have every path laid open to woman, as freely as to man. Were this done, we believe that the divine would ascend into nature to a height unknown in the history of past ages, and nature, thus instructed, would regulate the spheres not only so as to avoid collision, but to bring forth ravishing harmony." Toward the end of her treatise, Fuller argued that, for a human soul to reach its utmost development, it needed to be acknowledged as requiring a twofold growth, both masculine and feminine. The ideal spirit combined both power and beauty, she said, both energy and harmony, intellect and love, and there was no person whose attributes were either thoroughly masculine or completely feminine. These qualities were virtues, no matter the shape of the body in which they resided, and there could be little in the way of human progress until both sides of every person were respected and encouraged. Fuller observed, quote, "In some families I know, some little girls like to saw wood, others to use carpenter's tools. Where these tastes are indulged, cheerfulness and good humor are promoted. Where they're forbidden, because such things are not proper for girls, they grow sullen and mischievous." Fuller's solution for such disaffected girls and for society in general was that they be allowed to follow a natural law of growth that she said speaks in us and demands the perfection of each being in its kind, apple as apple, woman as woman. As to what positions then closed to women they might be permitted to fill, Fuller imposed no boundaries whatever. She famously urged, "Let them be sea captains, if you will." I've implied earlier that Fuller's power to become a truly transformative life was diminished by historical circumstance. I've not yet mentioned the cruelest of those circumstances, the fact that Fuller's life was cut short at the age of 40 when she perished in a shipwreck off the coast of Fire Island. It may well be that Fuller's greatest creation was her restless, ever self-transforming identity. But when that self was destroyed so young, her legacy was already greatly lessened. She was not abetted either by the generations of critics and historians who came immediately after her and tended to classify her as what they called an intellectual monstrosity, or to suggest, in the words of one, "Perhaps it was a mistake to force her into the rigid groove of classical learning when she should have been playing with her dolls." It became acceptable even to imply that Fuller's early death was a retribution for her daring to do something other than be a rather literary wife and mother. Vernon Parrington no doubt spoke the minds of many when he proclaimed, "If she had married early, as Harriet Beecher did, and her excessive energy had been turned into domestic channels, her life might have been less tragic, whatever the effect might have been on her intellectual development." But we may be all grateful, we may all be grateful, that Margaret Fuller did not content herself with dolls or domestic channels. One of the young women whom Fuller addressed in the Boston conversation she gave in the early 1840s happened to be Elizabeth Cady Stanton, who then authored the famous Declaration of Sentiments for the Seneca Falls Convention 5 years later. To this day, people who take the time to read and learn about Margaret Fuller tend to find themselves thinking differently about life, about gender equality, and about themselves. For about 10 years of my life, I had the privilege of first studying the Alcott family and then Margaret Fuller. And it should be then no wonder that, with all due apologies to Lou Gehrig, I consider myself the luckiest man on the face of the earth.
I apologize for the microphone. This is our first time in the room using it. There's some bad feedback. I think it'll be better with these microphones.
Okay,
can you hear us still?
Okay, good.
Okay, great. So we're going to continue this. I asked John, you know, it's a bit of a shorter lecture than maybe a classical length, but it leaves us more time to talk together. And some people have told me that's their favorite part of the evening, you know, when they get a chance to...
It's my favorite part.
Good, good. Well, you just mentioned Elizabeth Cady Stanton.
Yeah.
Her father and she were also very close, mm-hmm. but in a quite a different way. And mm-hmm. and you read the story of Elizabeth Cady Stanton, and you learn of this father who really did not support her, mm-hmm. Her life in feminism, and it was by standing up to him and disobeying him, mm-hmm. and breaking from his approval, that she found her voice. Mm-hmm. It's kind of interesting to compare that model to Fuller's story with her father, who tried to make her into his own image.
Absolutely.
You want to say something more about that?
Well, yeah, I mean, the relationship between Margaret Fuller and her father, Timothy, was a very difficult and fraught one, because Timothy Fuller believed strongly in the educational possibilities of you know, raising intelligent young girls, and Margaret was his oldest child. And he regarded her somewhat as an experiment, somewhat in the same way that Bronson Alcott regarded his children, but a more intellectual experiment than a moral experiment. And so here was Timothy Fuller cramming Margaret with all of this, you know, arcane information, teaching her Latin, teaching her Greek, to the extent that Margaret Fuller began to have horrible nightmares. She would read in Virgil's Aeneid about, you know, tearing the branch off of the dead tree and blood coming out, and she had these nightmares that were like something out of The Shining, you know, just blood all over and just really, really horrendous, and sleepwalking and all sorts of youthful disturbances. And Timothy Fuller eventually pulled back in a couple of ways. For one, he didn't try the same experiment on any of his younger children. He saw that that had been possibly a mistake, and he realized that there was something else to raising children than just making, you know, great intellects out of them. But he also pulled back because Margaret inevitably became an adolescent. And then the question became, well, what do we do with this hyper-educated young woman who, surprise, surprise, is lagging a bit in her social development because she's had her nose in the book constantly. And both Timothy and his wife, who was also named Margaret, were frightened to death that they really had created a monster. And that's why they sent her to finishing school. That's why they tried to turn her into a proper young lady. And that's the moment in which the rift really takes place between Margaret and her father. She can't understand, why have you betrayed me? Why did you set me up to be an intellect? Why did you educate me for the life of an educated New England man, and then completely pull the rug out from under me? Fuller was both blessed and cursed by the fact that that Timothy passed away when she was 25. Because he was out of her hair, he couldn't hold her back. But at the same time, he left a not very prosperous estate, and Margaret ended up having to sacrifice quite a bit of her time and effort to support her younger siblings, to get two of the brothers into Harvard, and so on.
In the long run, would you say his influence was more positive than negative? I mean, how did she come to think of him later in her life? Was she happy she had him as a father?
Yeah, her later recollections of him were quite forgiving.
Yeah.
And she did, at the age of about 30, write out this document that we know now called the Autobiographical Romance, in which she really makes Timothy look like a monster. But it was a romance. It was meant to be fiction. It was not really what she, I think, really felt about him. And the family, when this was published in the memoirs of Margaret Fuller that were edited by Emerson and Clark and Channing, were up in arms because they felt that Timothy had been so misrepresented.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I have one more question, then I want to see who else has some questions. Interestingly, I have a simple question. First of all, did Margaret Fuller ever meet or hear Frederick Douglass? I'm asking that because our inaugural lecture here was on Frederick Douglass. We've had an interest in his life.
Yeah.
And their lives are roughly contemporary.
Yes.
In fact, their books emerge in the exact same year.
Exactly.
Douglass's narrative and the woman of the 19th century.
In 1845.
Right.
Yes.
Had she ever met him, or did she first encounter him in that book?
To my knowledge, she never met him, but she did encounter the book, and she read it, and she reviewed it for Greeley's Tribune. And for those of you who are interested, that's published in a book called Margaret Fuller Critic that was edited, I believe, by Joel Meyerson. Is it Joel Meyerson? Anyway, Judith Matson Bean is the other one. And Fuller has very positive things to say about Douglass as being an exemplar of African American intellect, and as walking evidence that, yes, you know, racial equality makes all the sense in the world. But to my knowledge, they did not cross paths.
But she certainly knew of his reputation yes. as a great speaker.
By all means.
And you in your book have a fascinating passage where you compare and contrast those two figures.
Right.
Both of whom were quite extraordinary yeah. in their speech, mm-hmm. but differed in their literary impact on the page.
Yeah. Douglas was able to translate his gifts for speech into a gift for writing. And one of the things that's very interesting about Douglas's written work is it has a very oratorical kind of feel to it. He doesn't overcomplicate things. He puts things into extremely vivid word pictures, as one would do as an orator. And it's one of the reasons that Douglas's work is so popular, I think, with students today. It doesn't seem stilted. It doesn't really seem literary in a sense, although there's a lot of literariness going on. It's much more approachable. The problem with Margaret Fuller was, as Emerson said, her pen was a non-conductor. She was evidently fabulous as a speaker and just riveting, exciting, and very compelling. But then when she turned to writing, and particularly this is true in women of the 19th century, she seems to feel that she needs to prove all by herself that women are the intellectual equals of men. And so she has citations to about 8 different Shakespeare plays, and she has citations to Goethe and to Schelling, and so on and so forth. She just tries to cover the entire map. And so the book is a chore of Himalayan difficulty, honestly, to get through. And although it enjoyed some popularity, even her friends told her that it was, it was as if this vase of flowers had about 5 times the flowers in it that it actually does. It was just too much, in a sense. Yeah.
And yet you admire it, do you not, as an accomplishment of and didn't yeah. it give hope and to many women who saw it? Just the fact yeah. that it existed
yeah.
opened up doors.
Oh, I think absolutely. Yeah. That's beyond
yeah.
question.
Yeah. Let's see if we could ask if anybody in the room would like to join in. And Caitlin, who is the assistant director of the center, is going to bring a microphone around and see if you'd like to ask a question or make a comment. Anybody? Martha Hodes.
Thank you so much for that wonderful lecture. My question stems from the idea of writing a biography of somebody who was so acutely aware of herself as having a transformative life.
Yeah.
And also from the quotation about her pen as a non-conductor.
Yeah.
So my question is about how you approached her sources, especially unpublished sources. I assume there were letters and journals. You did allude to a journal.
Yeah.
And if you could tell to what degree those personal writings were crafted mm-hmm. for the eyes of others, in the case of her journals, or for people beyond the recipients, in the case of her letters. So I would phrase it as, could you tell, could you surmise, mm-hmm. and did it matter to you as a biographer?
Okay, I'll do the best I can with that. It's a fascinating question. Fuller's letters are actually published. It's a 6-volume set edited by Robert N. Hudspeth and just of invaluable assistance, obviously. The difference between her letters and her journals, and the journals are much more fragmentary and much in shorter supply, is that the journals are much less filtered. Okay. The journals really seem to have been personal documents. Within them, she's willing to confess some very problematic feelings, of course, for Anna Ward that I shared with you. That's stuff that never found its way into the letters. I think Fuller was very much aware of the possibility of a broader audience for her letters. And while they're not necessarily, they don't come across as being, particularly secretive and guarded, but you do get the feeling that you're getting a somewhat more edited self. So that's absolutely true. Is that enough of an answer to the question, or are there other parts to it that I'm not recollecting?
Just if it mattered to you as a biographer.
Mm. I think there are biographers who tend to
be a little bit more aware of that sort of level of candor rising up and down. It's something that I very much noted in talks given by other biographers who tend to, maybe in some ways, to be a little bit cagier than I am. I don't know. I'm just, you know, sort of trusting and innocent and believing, I suppose. But in, you know, in any case, I think if you want, you know, a sense of the, you know, of the unfiltered Fuller, the fragmentary journals are going to be more revelatory. But the letters are fascinating, and they're actually better written than the things that she was writing for a completely open public. In part because, you know, we talk with our students often about high stakes writing versus low stakes writing, and for Fuller, as for Bronson Alcott, high stakes writing was very difficult, and she felt this pressure, I feel, to be very formal, to sound extremely erudite, when in fact she could have gotten by with a good deal less. Sure. Yes.
Ron, sure now.
First of all, thank you for an excellent presentation. As I was listening to you describing Margaret Fuller's childhood, there are the most extraordinary parallels to the childhood of John Stuart Mill.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. For those, probably most of the people in this audience, yeah, you know this story, but I mean, I think he was brought up, he knew Latin by age 4 and Greek by age 6, and he felt that his father had brought him up as this perfect little reasoning machine, and then when he's an adolescent, he reads Wordsworth, and to his amazement, he discovers that he has emotions, and there was, yeah, tremendous resentment that he felt, right, that he'd been used, mm-hmm, as this experiment for his father's utilitarian, yeah, ideas. Was Margaret Fuller aware of this story? Was John Stuart Mill aware of Margaret Fuller's story?
Goodness. Well, Fuller actually became friends with a friend of Mill's, and that's Thomas Carlyle. Okay, so there's an overlap, sort of an intersection involving him, but I was not able to uncover any you know actual interactions. Now it is interesting because Mill actually has a full on nervous breakdown, right? You know, at a certain point, he's just been so hyper educated and feels, you know, such a betrayal from his father. That doesn't quite happen with Fuller in the same way, although there's a period in her early 30s where she's writing this really kind of weird experimental fiction, you know, with talking magnolia trees and women who transform into rainbows and things like that. And I would imagine that some of her friends were a little worried about Margaret at that point. But Fuller does arrive at a point of forgiveness where her father's concerned. And once again, you know, to refer back to the earlier question, this is a really interesting difference between the public Fuller and the private Fuller. Because the public Fuller in Woman in the 19th Century talks about a kind of alter ego of hers, whom she calls Miranda, of course, from the Tempest, and how Miranda's father has brought her forward and has educated her like a young man, and it's been a great thing for Miranda, liberating in every possible sense of the word. She doesn't label it Margaret and Timothy. She labels it Miranda and the unnamed father, the Prospero figure. Okay, but that's her public discussion of the pedagogical father-daughter relationship. It's very positive. But then we go to the autobiographical romance, where she talks about all of the crazy nightmares and the sleepwalking and a father who just won't relent. And that's very condemnatory. So once again, you kind of have your choice. You know, people say you're entitled to your own opinion. In some ways, you're entitled to your own Margaret Fuller. And let me say, by the way, it is a pleasure to converse with you. I heard you give the keynote address at a bio conference a couple years ago, and just sat saying to myself, "Wow," and tried to track you down later, and didn't have any success. But it's
wow in return.
Okay, thanks very much.
Neil McCarthy, back.
I have two questions, neither of which have anything to do with each other. The first question is, in terms of impacts on her life, did your research uncover, or did she ever meet Karl Marx, and did that have any impact? And my second question, right, is, following or starting with your premise that in many respects we are Ms. Fuller's audience.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if there were any other future audiences for to whom she spoke and who had an impact on her. And in particular, I'm wondering whether Eleanor Roosevelt had read Margaret Fuller and whether Fuller had any impact on her.
Okay. I don't know. It's a fascinating supposition. It's entirely possible that Eleanor Roosevelt was influenced by Fuller. I would consider it, you know, not knowing anything about any actual, you know, smoking gun, it seems likely. Now, the question about Karl Marx is interesting, and I think I understand why you asked it, because Karl Marx also worked for Horace Greeley, right? Was a columnist for the New York Tribune. To my understanding, there was no meeting that ever took place between Fuller and Karl Marx. However, Fuller did become very close friends with Giuseppe Mazzini. Okay, so the leading Italian revolutionary of the moment. She first met him when she was passing through London in, I think, it was either 1846 or possibly 47, probably 47 as I'm thinking of it. And they were actually introduced by Carlyle. And Fuller was fascinated by Mazzini. Mazzini was exiled from Italy. He had come to London, and as he was, you know, planning his return, trying to get back to Italy to lead a revolutionary movement, Mazzini founded a school in London for little Italian boys who had been basically kidnapped from Italy and had been brought to London, I think basically to be kind of little Artful Dodgers and Oliver Twists, and they had been rescued from the Fagans of the time, and Mazzini led a movement to prosecute the people who had kidnapped the children, but he was also educating them, and Fuller thought that was just the neatest thing she had ever seen. So then in Rome as well, as the revolution is collapsing, Fuller and Mazzini also spend some time together. That's pretty meaningful. Yeah.
Sorry, as a follow-up, part of the reason I asked the question is because she was so active in 1848. And
yeah.
In 1848, there are revolutions all over Europe.
Exactly.
And Engels and Marx, that was like part of their early period. But the other reason I asked the question is, not having read your biography, which I will.
Thank you.
In hardcover.
She found the reading of German philosophy to be a little bit difficult. Okay, welcome to the club, right? And so there are letters in which she you know writes to, I believe it's what is the man's name, Frederick Henry Hedge, who had studied in Germany and became a friend of Fuller's. She would write to him and say, well, what is Fichte saying here? I really don't get it. And Schelling also, and so you know she's very excited by German Romantic thought. Okay, Novalis really excites her, for instance. But in terms of her specific reactions to Hegel, I don't know of anything. I can't pull it off the top of my head, and I have no doubt that she would have at least attempted it. But her interest in German literature seemed a little bit, it was a highly philosophical interest, but she was more interested in the literary text than the philosophical text. Okay.
Yes, please.
I was wondering if you could say what you can tell us about her relationship to Emerson, because it seems to me a rather difficult one, particularly...
Yes.
I get the feeling from what I've read about her is that he never fully acknowledged her abilities.
Mm. I think he was acknowledging of her abilities, and he certainly did not scruple against kind of taking advantage of those abilities, okay, because he does bring her in to be the editor of the Dial. He promises her a generous cut of the profits from the magazine. Unfortunately, there never are any. You know, one of the leitmotifs of Fuller's life is working for the male transcendentalists and never getting paid. Okay, which is one of the reasons that she finally said, "The heck with you guys! I'm coming to New York, where Greeley's at least going to send me a check." Okay, so but as far as Emerson is concerned, you know, Fuller idolizes Emerson from the start. She says when she's in her early 20s that he's the one minister who she hasn't been able to meet, and he's the one that she most wants to meet. Finally, they meet the year after Timothy Fuller dies, and some people speculate that she was sort of looking to him as a surrogate father figure. But they finally do meet, and Emerson is at first very put off because, you know, what is this creature? And he says to himself, "We shall never get far." But then she keeps talking. And she's funny, and she has these wonderful incandescent insights into people they both know, and he finds himself being drawn in. Now, it's interesting, you know, Fuller was nearsighted, so she tended to lean a little bit forward. And Emerson also, in conversation, you know, leaned forward, and they were both compared to birds of prey. So when they were together, you can sort of imagine these two eagles sort of leaning toward each other. You know, Fuller's complaint with Emerson was that he was a cold fish. And Emerson himself said that he didn't possess animal spirits. And Fuller wanted a warm relationship as well as an intellectual relationship. And one of the things that was terribly annoying to her was that Emerson seemed to get on just fine with some of Fuller's female friends, like Anna Ward, Anna Barker Ward, and also Caroline Sturgis, okay? And so it's frustrating and angering to Fuller that she and Emerson can relate only on an intellectual basis. And Emerson writes to her and says, "Well, what do you want? You know, do you want me to relate to you physically? That would disgust you. So what, you know, where are we supposed to fit?" And so there's this kind of static electricity between the two of them that, that, you know, to extend the metaphor, produces some sparks, but it also just prevents them from coming together in a way that is satisfying, finally, for either one of them. But in terms of appreciating Fuller, one of the things that Emerson writes in his journal after Fuller's death is, "I have lost my audience." And so that suggests that he appreciated her uniquely as a person who was capable of understanding him, at least on an intellectual level. Ah, okay. Yeah, okay. There's 2 years or so after Fuller's death, Emerson collaborates with James Freeman Clark, whom I mentioned in the lecture, and William Henry Channing, not William Ellery Channing, but William Henry Channing, who's a nephew of the great Unitarian minister. And they assemble they assemble reminiscences from various of Fuller's friends. They solicit everyone they can think of for letters, and they pull together what they publish as the memoirs of Margaret Fuller Ossoli. Okay, and the first third dealing with her childhood and adolescence is written by James Freeman Clark. Then Emerson takes over around you know, the mid 1830s and stays with her about till the time she goes to New York, and then William Henry Channing takes over. So it's this sort of tripartite, you know, kind of tribute to her, but one that's very problematical because there are some things that they sweep under the rug, and also it did not occur to them that Fuller's documents would be of interest to future scholars, and so they would, you know, sometimes, you know, cut things up physically and paste them and so on and so forth. It just doing, you know, irreparable damage to the legacy. But anyway, so that's kind of the quick thing about the memoirs. What was your Okay. Okay, great.
Thank you very much. It was a wonderful talk.
Oh, you're more than kind. Wonderful audience.
We have time for a few more questions, and then we're going to wrap up and go to our reception.
Yeah.
Who would like to ask something? Yes, sir.
So, thanks again. It was a great talk.
There's a mic coming down toward you if you want it.
Okay. Quick. Hi. So, thanks again. It was very interesting talk, and I was particularly interested in something you said during the talk about how she was, you know, she was influential in the sense that she imagined a new womanhood, right? This radical imagination she has. Mm-hmm. And so I guess I have two questions about that. And the first is, what do you think accounts for this radical imagination that sets her apart?
Wow.
And I mean, that's maybe an unanswerable question. Mm-hmm. You talked a little bit about her father, who, you know, I think maybe pointed her in a certain direction, but mm-hmm. I feel like we should give her some more credit for living a lifetime of that imagination.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then the second question is, do you think that she saw herself as exceptional in that imagination, or was mm-hmm. that a sort of idealized model of other women that she hoped would be taken up?
Margaret Fuller was not known for her modesty. Okay, she actually did have a way of putting people off. And in part, I think, because when she was very young, she got love and attention at home by being smart. Okay, and so she carried that into her... her adult life for a very long time, thinking, well, if I'm the smartest girl in the room, of course people will be attracted to me. And it didn't necessarily work out for her in the way that that she anticipated. But she wrote, actually, this is a letter that she wrote to the man who eventually married Anna Barker, that she had met all of the outstanding intellects in America, and none of them came up to her. Okay. So she was not shy, and she was not, but I think in some ways both comfortable and uncomfortable with her uniqueness. I think she loved being as scintillatingly, you know, bright as she was, but I think also it was for her a kind of a lonely thing. As far as where the imagination comes from, It's very interesting because she felt somehow that she was not original in this sort of particular way. She would, I think, have loved to have been a poet or a musician or a composer, someone who engaged greatly and deeply in original creation. And what she discovered was that her talents really were not as an originator, but as a critic. And she was really a very good literary and art critic, probably the best of her time, except maybe Edgar Allan Poe. Okay, she was really, really spot on when it came to evaluating and discussing other people's work. But this goes to another question that's related to yours, which is the whole notion of genius, okay, and the way in which genius gets understood and the way that it gets gendered as well. Okay, and there was a real question in Fuller's mind, and in the mind of her time, as to whether there could be such a thing as a female genius. Okay, that there was this stereotype that insisted that the man was the generative intellectual power. Okay, and she wrestled with that, and I think there were times when she was, you know, somewhat depressed that it seemed like it might even be true, and she didn't want it to be true. In that perhaps one way, she was hemmed in by the gender expectations of her time, in her seeming inability to accept herself or to create herself as what she would have considered a genius. Is that good? Okay, great. Yeah.
Jane Donaldson.
Any indication what kind of a parent she was?
She was not a particularly good parent. And it was really... You know, it was hard to write about in some ways because you work on someone for a long time, and unless that person, you know, if you're writing about Hitler, you don't ever develop a Stockholm syndrome, I hope, but very often you do kind of fall in love with your subject, and Fuller, unfortunately, I was unable to really represent her parenthood as being that positive. Okay, so here's what happens with the parenthood: she becomes pregnant with a boy whom they call Nino, and realizes that she can't be seen around Rome in an interesting condition. So she abruptly stops writing for the Tribune for about 6 months, goes off into the countryside to have the baby, leaves the baby with a peasant family and pays them to look after the child and feed the child and so forth. Comes back to visit child about 4 months later and discovers that they've just been feeding him bread soaked in wine, and the kid is horribly malnourished and not of a proper weight, and the peasants are violent, they get drunk and they throw bottles at each other and furniture and stuff. But she leaves the child there. And she says in one of her letters to Giovanni, who the father of the child, well, this is part of little Nino's strengthening. And, you know, not so sure about that. Also, when Fuller is on the ship that is to bring Ossoli and her and the boy back to America, which, the wreck takes place, the captain of the ship develops virulent smallpox, and she brings the little boy in to see him when he's ill. Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah. And the captain actually does die. And Nino, in fact, contracts smallpox on the ship and recovers, only then to drown a few weeks later. But that's not a really great sign of parenthood either. Now Fuller feels affectionately toward the boy, and she in some of her letters from Florence, writes very glowingly about parenthood and how it's changed her and made her better and so forth. But unfortunately, she is one of that long list of bad transcendental parents. Okay, so that's the answer there.
I'm gonna ask one more question, I think, and then we're going to move toward a great final phase of the evening. The shipwreck, obviously, you don't want to make her whole life about her death.
Exactly.
But it is a very dramatic ending, and there's an attempt to get them ashore.
Mm-hmm.
I believe she ends up lashed to the mast, but somebody takes the baby and puts it in a sack and tries to swim it to shore.
Yeah.
And it's later found in the sack dead. And then when news of this horrible wreck reaches Concord, Massachusetts, Emerson dispatches Henry David Thoreau to go to the beach, which is out near Jones Beach somewhere, and to search for anything that might have drifted up, including the manuscript of the Italian Revolution that Margaret Fuller has written, which might be her masterpiece, and it's the only copy of.
Right, yeah.
So tell us about the... define that.
You've told us a bit about it already.
Okay.
It's really very good. Okay, the place where the ship hits a sandbar is a spot on Fire Island called Point O' Woods, which I've tried to get to, but it's actually a private community, and you can only get there by a special boat, and they won't let me on, so it's kind of tough. But anyway, Fuller is brought to her demise by the worst luck imaginable. A, they've got this first mate who's taken over from the dead captain, who apparently is great in the open water, but not really good at bringing the ship into harbor. And so he makes a navigational error of about 50 miles east, so that what he thinks is New York Harbor is actually going to be Fire Island, and he sails right toward it. Also, a hurricane comes up behind them. A hurricane in the middle of July, which those of you who know something about meteorology know, just doesn't happen on the East Coast. It's too early in the season. And in fact, there was no other hurricane that forceful at that season of the year for another 122 years. So she just really got a short straw. And then once the ship runs aground on a sandbar within 200 or 300 yards of land in the middle of the night, the sun comes up and the people on the ship see on the shore, oh my goodness, there are people on the shore. They see us. We're saved. Of course they'll send somebody out. Well, unfortunately, the people then living on Fire Island were basically thieves and scavengers and beachcombers who made a living basically waiting for ships to break up so that they could get the luggage that floated ashore. And one of the eyewitnesses later said, well, if we'd known anybody famous was on the ship, of course he would have sent a boat out. So not the best advertisement for human nature, unfortunately. But Thoreau does, he is dispatched. Oh, and by the way, 2/3 of the people on the ship actually did survive. But sadly enough, the crew did a lot better than the passengers did, as it turns out. But Thoreau is sent to the shore. it is not able to find very much. Fuller's body is never recovered. Her husband's body, they eventually did get married. We think no one's ever found the marriage certificate. His body was lost. The only body of the three that washed ashore was Nino's, and it was still warm. It was, you know, that close, you know, to surviving. But Thoreau goes down there. He finds a coat that belonged to Giovanni Ossoli, and he cuts the button off of the coat, and he talks about the in a journal, I think, about the irony of these things that are dead but survive, and living things that don't. But anyway, that's kind of the wrap up.
Thank you very much.